Now the last lecturer is somebody we have known for many, many years. Maybe you didn't know us, but we knew you. Dr. Kravtsov, Sergei Kravtsov, is a senior research associate at the Center of Jewish Art of the Hebrew University in Jerusalem. He was born in Lviv in Ukraine. He was trained as an architect in his native city. He received his doctoral degree in architectural history from the Institute for the Theory and History of Architecture in Moscow in 1993, and he moved to Israel in 1994. He has published about 60 essays on history of urban planning and synagogue architecture. He has authored and co-authored 4 books, and he is a very important part of the Center of Jewish Art until today. He is going to talk to us about Polish-Jewish art history discourse, from Karol Marszowski to Sofia Amesinova. At least one part of the title we know. Thank you very much.
Okay, you know Sofia Maizenova from a good side, now you will learn her from not from something else. Okay. An interest in Jewish art emerged among Polish scholars around 1890. It first surfaced in Galicia, at that time Austrian crown land that enjoyed autonomy and was seen by Poles as a kernel of a national state to be restituted. Studies started in Krakow and Lviv, Lemberg, Lviv, two ambitious academic centers surrounded by living Jewish communities with valuable monuments of architecture and art. Of course, the Christian art dominated the region. From the outset, the interest in Jewish art was charged with a Polish national agenda, being inspired by a desire to place Polish art in a broader historical context and to establish its relationship with that of its neighbors and minorities. The Jewish nationalism was rising and seeking a cultural identity too. My paper intends to explicate the methodologies and achievements of Polish art historians, to trace the involvement of Jewish scholars in the discourse, and to track its flow in the interwar Poland when the issue of Polish national restitution was losing its poignancy. Polish poet Adam Mickiewicz inaugurated this story in 1833 when he expressed the romantic and antiquarian view of a wooden inn and a synagogue as products of the ceramic skills brought to Poland by Jewish carpenters. Mickiewicz, however, mocked his own theory by describing an inn house as a combination of Noah's Ark and the Temple of Solomon by portraying an inn as a miserable Jew whose one pointed head is similar to the roof, whose dress resembles sooty and dirty walls, etc. Academic study of Jewish art only began about 1890, largely due to the interest of Professor Marian Sokolovsky, founder of the seat of art history at the Jagiellonian University. Along with his scrupulosity and of description and depth of contextualizing, Sokolovsky pursued in his studies a European-centered narrative underpinned by the Hegelian philosophy of immanent development. This paradigm guided his linking of monuments into chains, ordered by formal resemblance and chronology, and pinned to a geographical map. At the same time, the evolution theory left enough room for isolated groups of monuments, which for some historical reasons were detached from the progress of Western European art and thus preserved certain archaic features that had vanished elsewhere. To such relic groups, Sokolovsky assigned the art of the and architecture of Podhale and the art of Ukrainians considered constrained by their conservative Byzantine past. He believed that somnolence, stagnation, and passivity are characteristic traits of Oriental societies. He maintained that motives, on the first glance looking arcane and difficult to explain, originating from the forgotten and outworn times, are concealed in the late Byzantine ornament like antediluvian flies in amber. It was probably about such arcane motives that Sokolovsky was thinking when he emphasized Oriental and ancient characteristic features of a wooden synagogue in Yablonov, investigated by engineer Ludwig Wierzbicki in 1887. On this point, Sokolovsky disagreed with the historian Vincenty Wdovishevsky, who perceived those motifs as profoundly common, lacking stylistic features of distant epochs. Sokolovsky, nevertheless, insisted on publication of this material as previously unknown to science. Another early study of Jewish art in Galicia was a survey of the wooden synagogue in Dvozhets. That study was carried out in 1890-92 by Karol Mashkovsky, a son of the rector of the Lviv University under Sokolovsky's supervision. Mashkovsky wrote about the synagogue murals that the whole wall makes an impression of a rug. He saw the decorative motifs of this rug as Persian-related. Mashkovsky explained his reference to the remote Persia, by placing the origin of such a work in a world self-isolated from the rest of the society by a wall of tribal, religious, and custom differentiation. Mashkovsky also distinguished between the style of the wall painting and those of the cupola. He characterized the latter as products of some clumsy Baroque. Notwithstanding this stylistic differentiation, Mashkovsky suggested the existence of some Jewish artistic school in old Poland. In Sokolovsky's opinion, from the scholarly point of view, these monuments of Oriental construction on our soil may have their exceptional value, meaning in the frame of his Occidental overall paradigm. The same year, 1890, the Masonry Synagogue architecture and decoration attracted the interest of the painter, conservator, and art historian Vladislav Lushchkevich, an elder colleague of Sokolovsky and Mashkovsky's teacher of painting. Lushchkevich described an aperture in the bima superstructure of the 18th century synagogue in Przeworsk as cut in a shape resembling an Arabic ornamental motif. Other elements he characterized as Baroque with a Jewish admixture. Lushchkevich defined Baroque elements as preserving late Renaissance aesthetics while introducing a lot of originality and adjusting themselves to ritual requirements. His evaluation of a synagogue as late Renaissance was a compliment, since as a pioneer in the study of the early periods of Polish art, Lushchkevich scorned the Baroque as the manifestation of a spoiled taste. The search for original, indigenous Jewish features inspired Matthias Berzon this way, unpublished poetry. A Warsaw banker of Jewish origin, who as a historian and collector studied wooden synagogues in the lands of the Commonwealth. In his A Few Words on the Old Wooden Synagogues in Poland, published in Krakow and Warsaw, and commented on by Sokolovsky and Lushchkevich, Berzon wrote about olden wooden synagogues of an original shape and style which is difficult to describe. In his opinion, the indigenous conservatism and probably even more the poverty of Jewish communities in those small towns led to the preservation of a few old monuments not devoid of originality. Berzon considered the synagogue's corner pavilions, their diachronic annexes, and some decorative elements as original features. Finding these synagogues dissimilar from the surrounding, Berzon supports that their style was transferred from southeastern Silesia, with its typical wooden churches, to eastern Poland during the resettlement of the Ashkenazi Jews. Hence, Berzon's theory of Jewish art, or at least architecture, may be characterized as Occidental if compared to Mashkovsky's Oriental theory. All these theories were revised by Kazimierz Moklowski, an architect, folklorist, and social democrat activist, a student dismissed on grounds of political agitation from the Lwów Polytechnic. Moklowski moved to Switzerland and Germany, becoming involved in disputes with those comrades who rejected the struggle for an independent Poland for the sake of proletarian internationalism. On his graduation from the Technical University in Munich, Moklowski returned to Lwów, wrote where he studied his architectural practice and undertook a vast survey of folk architecture. He was encouraged by established scholars, by Jan Bolos Antoniewicz and Władysław Luzinski in Lwów, and Luszkiewicz and Sokolowski in Krakow. He was praised also in his political camp for basing his methodology on historical materialism. In his study, Folk Art in Poland, Moklowski first of all rejected the romanticist hieramic idea proposed by Mickiewicz. Likewise, he rejected Berzon's idea of borrowing patterns from the Polish synagogues from German Silesia, since the Silesian churches featured a different layout. Moklowski argued that the pattern for wooden synagogues with corner pavilions was a true monument of homebred construction art, a Polish landlord's manor house, in its turn modeled on ancient wooden fortification. This is the fortification. In his opinion, there was nothing originally Jewish in the massing, construction, and style of wooden synagogues in Poland. An alternative view formulated by Berzon was explicated by Moklowski as Jewish separatism. However, he agreed that the subjects of synagogue murals were of strictly Jewish content, while sharing the same style with neighboring churches. He also agreed that the synagogue silhouette stood out in Polish townscape, since our folk architecture, being absolutely sincere in its external expression of the interior, shows the entirely different ritual designation of the building. Moklowski was a national romanticism who believed that renunciation of one's own artistic face is not only a disaster for a particular people, but also for a world civilization. However, he didn't see any specifically Jewish input in Polish construction law, which was the key criterion for his historical materialist theory. From this standpoint, Moklowski promoted the Zakopane style as an overall Polish national style, while leaving no theoretical room for the existence of a Jewish style in Poland. Another stance on Jewish art and architecture was that of Józef Awin, an architect of Polish nationality and Jewish faith trained in Lwów, Vienna, and Munich. In his opinion, expressed in 1909, genuine Polish Jewish art, featuring its distinct stylistics, had existed for centuries in the ghetto in a state of great isolation. It was the barbarian breach of the traditional boundaries in the second half of the 19th century that caused an upsurge of architecture where one can find hardly any Jewish motifs. Everything is conventionally stylized in Baroque or Gothic, or if very religious, then Moorish, instead of good systematic development based on our eternal tradition. Judging from texts by Awin and his reviewers, he saw Jewish architecture as inherent, existent for centuries in the isolation of the ghetto, subconsciously felt and transmitted by Jewish architects, and hence Oriental by default. It was, however, inseparable from the historical townscape of Poland where it was produced. And indeed, one may see elements of Polish Baroque and Zakopane style in Awin's synagogue design. His theories combine the influence of two very different Zionist thinkers. Martin Buber, with his idea of cultural seeds covered under the sands of the ghetto and blossoming during the Jewish Renaissance, and Max Nordau, with his idea of good systematic development unblemished by degeneration. Arvin distanced himself from the historical materialism of Maklovsky, for whom national style developed from vernacular technique. Arvin's understanding of Jewish architecture was related to architect's psychology. He belonged to a younger generation of Lvov architects, including Witold Minkiewicz of Lvov Polytechnic, who understood that assessment of what may be accepted as native belongs to the emotional sphere of the artist, which is as elusive as the very concept of the native and cannot be defined by any formula, although its existence is undeniable. The years around the First World War witnessed a re-evaluation of Baroque as a pre-partition style in Poland. The lead was taken by Adolf Szyszko Bohusz, trained in St. Petersburg teaching and designing in Lviv and Krakow. Like Maklovsky, he assumed that all those monuments in Poland generally recognized as Jewish had barely any connection to Jewish culture, though the existence of the latter is undeniable. In his opinion, the Jewish component of synagogues in Poland derived largely from ritual demands. He believed that stylistically, masonry synagogues were Gothic, Renaissance, and Baroque, and it was only a sudden barbarization that gave them a charm of nativeness. However, he was able to see a serpentine, purely oriental design in the wooden synagogue of Przedbusz. Another Jewish component recognized by Szyszko Bohusz was the use of iconographical subjects. Being a propagator of neo-Baroque in restituted Poland, he advertised synagogues as examples of syncretism in the national, which he saw as aristocratic culture rather than vernacular law. He wrote, "Built mainly in the Baroque epoch, for us these synagogues are often gorgeous examples of Polish Baroque for such a builder who seeks to produce a Polish style as befitting the flourishing epoch of noble culture of the 17th and 18th centuries, half European and half Oriental, Baroque Asiatic, extraordinarily adjusted to our national character." It was the aforementioned Minkiewicz who explained the changes that occurred in the evolution of the Polish legacy during the pre-war and post-war decades. He wrote, "The discovery of Podhale and its folk lore captivated Polish architects. They tried to apply these forms even to masonry buildings. Then came disappointment, and national romantics tended to reproduce only the mood and general character of the monuments. However, soon after the restitution of the Polish state, this trend demonstrated its incapability, mainly in the pursuit of monumentality for new governmental buildings. As a result, the interest of architects turned towards the neoclassicism, and let us say, and Baroque, of the pre-partition epoch, and then modernism devaluated all these historicist attempts as unsuitable to the new social tasks, primarily housing. Thus, by 1930, practical architecture became much less interested in historical patterns and partially lost its nationalist appeal. A new stage in the study of Jewish art was inaugurated by Zofia Majzenova, an expert in Jewish illuminated manuscripts, who was trained and worked at the Jagiellonian University. In her studies on Jewish iconography, Majzenova drew upon works from scholars of the Vienna School, corresponded with Rachel Wischnitzer-Bernstein, and consulted the Warburg Library. In 1929, Majzenova published her work on the 14th century illuminated Hebrew Bible preserved in Krakow, already discovered earlier by Sokolovsky. She proceeded with the study of another Hebrew Bible, at that time kept in Lvov, and known today as the Wroclaw Bible, publishing her new work in 1933. Okay, we are running forward, but it doesn't harm. Amazinova connected Amazinova connected the features of these Western European works to those discovered in her home, in her homeland. In her opinion, treatment of visual forms in Jewish art was reduced to symbolic representations starting from the glass of Roman catacombs through medieval illuminated manuscripts from the Middle East and Western Europe to the murals of Polish synagogues and the paper cuts produced by contemporary Polish Jews. She praised Berzon for his revolutionary understanding of this pitch of Oriental beholding. Barely touched by European styles from Romanesque to Baroque until the modern art produced by Marc Chagall. Thus, she projected the understanding of Jewish art of her time onto the whole history of Jewish art. In her opinion, this Jewish art was that of the Jewish folk masses and not of the elite. The latter didn't differ greatly from the art of the neighbors. In her book on the Wroclaw Bible, Amazinova dwelt on a product of Ashkenazi elite culture and its pictorial bestiary. In her opinion, this bestiary helps to close the circle of Jewish iconography, the psychologus that grew from ancient Jewish naturalist speculation, was enriched with Hellenistic myths, had absorbed ancient forms of Babylonian and Assyrian imagination, was impregnated with splatters of Greek knowledge, Egyptian prejudices, and Indian legends, distilled in the alembic of Christian theology, victoriously marched through the whole of Europe and the Middle East, re-entering the Jewish milieu via illustrated bestiaries composed in European languages. From this elitist circle of Hebrew scribes, this bestiary penetrated Jewish folklore and re-emerged on the walls of synagogues of Poland and Ukraine. Her views didn't change significantly until 1939. The study of synagogue architectural history was preoccupied with architectural typology in those years. Szymon Zajcik, who was affiliated with the Warsaw Polytechnic, differentiated two types of masonry synagogues in Poland, those with four piers tightly surrounding a central located bima, and those with four piers dividing the interior space into nine even bays. Zajcik associated these types with the Renaissance and Baroque periods, respectively. Meyer Balaban, a Polish historian, coined the term fortress synagogue as a type and as a sign of Jewish participation in the defense of Poland, while attesting the four-pier synagogues as the result of Byzantine influences in eastern Poland. Returning to Józef Abin, we learn that in the 1930s he had abandoned national romanticism and embraced modernism. He also became a founder of the Jewish Museum in Lvov and one of its directors. In his article on old Jewish art, he presented a revised outline of Jewish art. The theme and formal layout coined by the Jews already in the first century before Christ was disseminated by them throughout the world in such a way that there is a certain iconographical continuity in Jewish art, and it is accompanied by certain indigenous unity of vision and artistic presentation. And then Avin refers to Amazinova. Perceived this way, Jewish iconography is present in every field of Jewish art. The consistency of the motifs used in decoration and the continuity of their stylistic tradition remained constant until the mid-19th century. After that period, the characteristic folk tune in the decorative output of all nations ceased. The national renaissance of art that occurred in the early 20th century was only a short episode. Together with the changes that emerged in the cultural life of nations after the World War, the folk elements are vanishing from art, and one can discern a collective effort by artists of all the peoples to find new means of expression in art. Presently, the Jewish artists are also active on this path. To conclude, Polish researchers of both Polish and Jewish origin sought continuous narratives in their respective art histories, constructed as national ones. Most of them preferred to emphasize the originality of their own lineage, either Polish or Jewish. A few others, like the young Avin and Balaban, tended to construct a joint narrative. Yet others, like Mokhlovsky, denied Jewish originality and rejected what they called Jewish separatism, proposing an integral Polish style for everyone. All these stylistic retrospections were forsaken with the advance of modernism, and the baton in the race for national originality passed to iconography. The underpinning paradigms changed from Hegelian dialectics to positivism, to Marxist historical materialism, and to post-positivism epistemology. Notwithstanding, art historians persistently return to the concept of indigenous and continuous Jewish art. Thank you.